broadcasting from the center of the universe and the Thrive15.com world headquarters.
Let's go!
Presenting the world's only business school without the BS, with optometrist and entrepreneur Dr. Robert Zellner and the former Small Business Administration Entrepreneur of the Year in your ear, Clay Clark. It's the Thrivetime Show. 3, 2, 1.
All right. Welcome back to the Thrivetime Show on your radio. My name is Clay Clark, and I could not be more excited to be here with you today. Joined inside the box that rocks with Sam, our executive producer, my incredible wife of 15 years, Mrs. Vanessa Clark, and the man, the myth, the legend, the man who has put the Z all over Tulsa like his name was Zorro. It is, it's not happening tomorrow. It is today. It is Dr. Robert Zellner. Sir, how are you?
I am fantastic. I'm having microphone issues over here, so if you're watching on Facebook Live, I'm fighting the microphone. And
well, it's because I moved around the box that rocks, and it doesn't feel comfortable.
Flip-flop me. I had my little space. I had it all dialed in. Now it's like giving me left-handed, golf clubs, and I'm a right-hander. I mean, I feel out of sorts.
I wasn't ready for it either. I didn't know what was going on when Sam I thought he was just hanging out with me for a second, Sam, and then he had to make his way back past.
Let me sell you on the vision. The vision is now you and I, we can look there onto the screen and monitor our mic volumes. For instance, I could say that see the mic volumes as I'm talking, waveform's working beautifully. Everyone's going to be equally loud. It's a beautiful thing for America. Right. America has improved as a result of this change.
I actually kind of like being able to look there, and there's some certain satisfaction of saying that is my voice on the mic and it is right.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, no, I went old school. I would just use my ears last time.
Oh,
I mean, I know it's crazy.
Wow.
I know, but when it sounded loud enough, I knew it was.
Now, today's...
No, I like the thing, though.
Today's show has a potential to be the deepest and most helpful show we've ever done, and we're talking about how to apply pressure to get things done, and really, are you rejecting the motive or the method? Oh, so again, how to apply pressure to get things done, Z. Z, are you ready for this?
Oh, this is one of my favorite topics, how to apply pressure, how to get her done.
So page 2 of our notes, here are the scenarios for you, okay? Here are the scenarios. Let's say you own a business and you're trying to gather Google reviews, but you can't seem to get people to do it. Maybe you don't know how to apply the right pressure. Let's say you're struggling to close some deals. Well, maybe it's because you don't know how to apply the pressure. Maybe you're struggling to recruit people. Maybe you're struggling to get a seat at a bar. You're just trying to get a seat to sit down at the bar stool. Maybe you're having a hard time upselling. Maybe you have a hard time dealing with the price objection. Z, why is it so hard for many people to overcome that feeling of feeling bad when they pressure somebody to do something that they sincerely believe in? What's that all about?
Well, we've all been pressured to do something that is either something we should do or shouldn't do.
Yep.
I mean, growing up, we've all had positive peer pressure. We've all had negative peer pressure. We've all had, pressure from our spouses, pressure from our kids, pressure from our family, pressure from bosses. And so we've all been in it. And none of us really, nobody really runs toward pressure. I mean, if you're a person that wakes up and says, oh, man, I sure hope I getting the pressure cooker today. I mean, I'm somewhat squeezing my head in a vise to do something. I can hardly wait. No, it's natural to kind of deviate from that or run from that. And so that being our default, that being kind of the way we are, for us to be able to put other people in it, then most of us know that it's uncomfortable on them. And so therefore we're like, I really don't want to do that because, I've just started my own business. Now I'm a boss and I want everybody to like me and I want them to work for me and I want them to row the boat with me because rowing the boat's how I'm going to get financial freedom and time freedom. And so I don't want to upset anybody.
Now, Vanessa, you are somebody who we've been married for 15 years. And you tell me if I'm wrongly describing you.
Okay.
You're somebody that doesn't like to rock the boat if possible. Is that a correct description or am I
going to? No, that's right. And actually, I think I've had to learn over the years the correct way to say, okay, this is when I need to say something or the right way to say it. But my default is to keep the peace, which is so funny, just in different situations that we come up, I've learned to address things. But yeah, I like that peace. Like to sit there.
I think Z was talking about people who wake up hoping they get in the pressure cooker. I might have a psychological problem, but I'm going to tell you this. I actually, as a general rule, prefer confrontation.
He likes it.
When somebody's absolutely wrong.
But you're not normal. I'm just saying, you are far from normal. You are outside the bell curve of normal.
Well, here's an example.
In a lot of different ways.
But this is why I think I've had to learn to step up and be like, okay, how do I, and you've taught me that because I'm like, I will get steamrolled.
All right, so here's an example though. I feel like a lot of listeners right now, what you have a problem with, we're confusing are the motive and the method. So I have an example. Z, I've done some research for this example on page two. I'm ready to give it to you. You ready? You're an American. An American historian. You love history. So I'm going to give it to you. Okay. So here we go. Tell me if this example makes sense. So back in the day, 1776 is when we gained our independence, right? But before that, like 1774, 1775, we had this thing called the war going on, the Revolutionary War. Am I correct up to this point?
Yes, you're being accurate now.
Okay, so George Washington, you know, we'll call him G-Dub to make it relevant. G-Dub. Our man's got wooden teeth, and he pulls his guys aside. He pulls out. So imagine that you and Vanessa are in the army of G-Dub back in 1770, whatever, okay?
We're in the army now.
So this is what I would have said. Yep. This is what every leader would have said previous to George Washington.
Okay.
All right, Z, I want you to get in a row. You're row one.
Okay. Do I have my musket? Do I have a musket?
Exactly.
And Vanessa, am I good enough to have a musket?
You get a musket, and Vanessa's in row two.
I would like to be behind him. I don't want to be the front of my row.
Here's the deal. You guys have, I say, all right, guys, here's the deal.
I'm a human shield now. That's what I need.
Yeah, so here you go, guys.
All right, I'll leave.
You guys need to march in rows. Now, wait, but before we march into battle, the guys are going, do we need anything else? Are you sure this idea of marching in rows is a good move? Listen, you're right. We forgot something. We need a drummer and a guy to play the trumpet.
A flag guy.
And a guy to hold the flag. But yes, get back. And they're like, oh, good. So will that save us from certain death? Absolutely not. Get in rows and we'll fight until somebody runs out of ammo. And then you just marched in rows. Why did people do that back in the day? I mean, do you know the logic behind that? Why previously to George Washington did everybody march in rows? What was all that all about?
Well, it was a gentleman's way of doing it.
A gentleman's way of...
And as gentlemen, see, back in the day, they would have what they call, we're one-on-one, where you have a...
Duel.
Duels, yes. So they were dual style, and that had kind of, with the guns, kind of transformed into that. And so you stood very... Because the accuracy of those things was not very good.
Okay? Yeah, I always thought the same thing. Why not just shoot the guy before he's ready? Instead, they had this whole pageantry around it.
That's not gentlemen.
That's right.
That's not the way men did it back in the day.
So here's what I'd be going through my mind, like, you guys march in rows. Meanwhile, I'm going to fall on the ground and pretend like I've already been shot. And you guys go ahead and do that. You guys carry out that plan. Well, anyway, George Washington said, okay, here's the deal. I got a new move. And the guy goes, what? He goes, you guys can hide behind trees today. And they're like, what? Get to live. So he's the first guy to do these three rules that allowed us to win. But many of you listening right now, you're rejecting the method, and you're confusing that with the motive. Okay, so the motive that GW had was to win our independence from England. That was the goal.
Broadcasting live from the center of the universe, you're listening to the Thrivetime Show.
So his motive was right. He wanted to gain independence from England, and he didn't want to die in the process. That was his motive. But his method, here are the methods that he did that everyone thought were unethical. Method number one, they said, you cannot hide behind trees. They thought that was totally shady to hide behind a tree. Literally shady, you see what I did
shady,
there?
Shady, yes.
Now, the second thing they thought was, you definitely cannot shoot the leaders. So back in the day, you know, the leader of the army would be up on a horse, and the men, you know, were all like subservient to the leader. The leader is like, there's kind of a gentleman's rule that you don't shoot the guy on the horse.
And really, he's like a perfect target. He's on the horse. You know who he is. It's obvious. Why would you not?
So G-Dub's like, here's the deal, guys. We're going to shoot the leader, because once they do, all the people will scatter. And they're like, is that ethical? Like, I don't know if it's ethical or not, but I'm doing it. So they basically hid behind a tree, climbed in the tree, and went, and they shot the leader. Oh, all of a sudden, the British disperse, and this happens. Well, then, so now they're starting to win, but we're still outnumbered. And so the final super ridiculous thing he did that many of the people back in the day disagreed with, I mean, people thought these motives were okay, but they thought the methods were terrible. They thought his motive was pure, but his method was wrong. So method number one, you can't hide behind trees. Two, you can't shoot the leaders. And three, mandatory inoculation. You know, smallpox was killing more people than the war was. And so they thought back in the day, if you believed in inoculation, you were like a witch or a demonic spirit of some kind. And so he goes, here's the deal. If we take the disease from one man and we cut off part of his skin and we put it on another guy, that'll inoculate you and keep you from getting the full-blown disease. And they're like, he's a crazy witch doctor. I ain't going to do that. And he's like, you have to do it. It's required. And he required his people to do inoculation, and that's why we overcame smallpox, the first person in the history of modern warfare to do these crazy things. So again, the motive, we all agree with the motive, but many people were rejecting the method. And so if you're listening right now and you want to convince your client to take action, you want to get some Google reviews, you want to close deals, you want to sell more stuff, first off, before we teach you these methods, please 100% mentally either agree or disagree with your motive. Because if you believe in your product, Z, should you ever be embarrassed to sell a product that you personally believe in?
No, you shouldn't be. And they, you know, they call that back in the day guerrilla warfare, by the way.
Ooh.
And you know why they call it guerrilla warfare?
It's primitive.
A lot of monkeys?
Well, because no, they were hiding, and they were kind of like the gorillas in the forest. So, you know, and really, GW started it, but it was really all kind of the non-military guys that adapted it first.
Mm.
So it was
the farmers with the pitchforks. It wasn't because their traditional
armies
were
defending
their
lands and everything from the taxes being taken.
Yeah, they were doing all the shady kind of stuff. You know, which back in the day was groundbreaking. I mean, and they needed to do it. They just couldn't match up person for person and try to beat them.
And so this show is all about helping the small business owners win. And you can't just match up. You can't just go head to head with the biggest.
You can't just match up with Walmart and just say, hey, I'm going to do what you do. You do what you do. And let's just both do the same thing. And may that. No, they'll crush you.
If you're listening right now and you're an aspiring optometrist, right, we hope you change the station. But when Z, back in the day, when you started, when you started your business, you were going up against the big guys.
The big boys.
The big kahunas.
The big kahunas.
Now you are the big kahuna.
Yes. So, and the way I took care of things and looked at things back then was different than the way I look at them now, seriously. So we're
trying to teach everybody who's listening today how to become successful, except for anybody who's an optometrist. If you're an optometrist,
don't implement. Oh, no. There's a lot of communities, a lot of fine people out there, and it's a big enough pie that we can all make a living. We can all get along.
He'll leave crumbs on the pie tin.
He'll leave some along.
All right. So we're gonna teach you after the break the specific moves that you can implement to get things done, but they don't work if you're not 100% mentally resolved that you have the right motive. Because if you do these moves and you don't agree with the motive and you don't agree that you're even doing something that should be done, you won't want to do them. And so again, just a quick recap. If you've ever struggled to get Google reviews, we're going to teach you how. If you've ever struggled to close a deal, we're going to teach you how to do it. If you've ever struggled to recruit people, to get a seat at the bar, to upsell something, to deflect the price question. Z, if you've ever struggled to get something done, we're going to teach the power pressure moves. The power pressure moves.
I tell you what, you don't want to miss this show because, you know, we're going to give you practical steps on how you can use, you know, guerrilla warfare.
Yes.
Business is war.
It is.
It is war.
And if you're on Facebook Live. If you're on Facebook Live right now, it is also Phil Pickle's birthday. Phil Pickle is one of the founders of the My Anchor Insurance Group. And so we've got him a pickle jar in anticipation of his Phil Pickle performance right there. So I'm excited about Phil Pickle.
That's kind of crazy.
Yeah, I mean, what do you buy a guy who's financially free, has time freedom? I'll tell you what you buy him. You buy him a big jar of pickles named after because his name's Pickle.
So original.
It took me about 4 hours to come up with that idea.
So original. He's probably never been given pickles before.
Stay tuned. ThrivetimeShow.com.
I'm Ken Pilot, and I'm from Tulsa, Oklahoma. Professional painting by Ken. Quite a bit of stuff. A lot of stuff I know that I needed to do but didn't know how to do it. Web page, how to hire people, sales, making a schedule, making programs. I mean, just a lot of stuff. I mean, it's overwhelming, but it's good stuff that you can actually put to practice right away. It's a lot different than I expected. Been to different workshops, and you're just waiting for the sales punch, you know, and they give you ideas and stuff, but it's always 10 years down the road when you can actually apply the stuff that they're trying to promote. And this is not like that at all. It's very ground level, help you start a business and maintain and grow a bigger business. I like it a lot because he makes you feel comfortable, makes you laugh, so it opens you up to receive and hear better. This is great. It's a lot of interaction. You can ask him questions. You can help. He can. I mean, if you don't understand something, he can explain it more. So it's very, very helpful. I mean, they're missing a lot because a lot of businesses probably do some of the steps that he's teaching, but there's so much they can learn and to easy steps that they'll grow their business even better. It's not like any other workshop I've ever been to. It's very laid back and a lot of information, and it's a comfortable setting. It's awesome. It's a really good experience.
All right, Thrive Nation, welcome back into the conversation. It is the Thrive Time Show on the radio. My name is Clay Clark, the former SBA Entrepreneur of the Year, sent here to help make your wallet happy. It's the Thrive Time Show, and we are joined here inside the box that rocks with Dr. Robert Zellner and my incredible wife of 15 years. Dr. Z, how are you, my friend?
I am fantastic. I'm real excited about it. I mean, we started off the show talking about guerrilla warfare. That just gets me. I mean, my juices are kind of pumping. I'm ready to go.
Talking today about how to pressure people to do the right thing when you believe what you're doing is the right thing. So I'm going to give you these ethical examples, dilemmas.
Hey, instead of saying pressure, we can use a few other adjectives in there. Or
encourage.
Adverbs.
Encourage them.
Threaten.
Motivate.
Force.
So typical of the personalities, right?
here's an example, though. If you are somebody who desperately wanted segregation to end in the 1960s, the civil rights movement, you had to convince people to vote in favor of ending segregation, which we all could look back at now and go, that was a stupid idea. Why did we ever do that? Let's have the pale people use that restroom and the people with a tan use that one. I mean, that wasn't a smart move. We look back and go, that was dumb. But for like hundreds of years, people are like, well, it just makes sense. I mean, that's just how it is. You know, so the thing is, you have to pressure people to get them to, you have to encourage.
Yeah.
You have to
motivate.
You have to
persuade. There's a reward or a penalty or, yeah.
So here is the first example where learning some negotiation, some motivation, some persuasion techniques would be helpful. The first one is to gather Google reviews. So here's the scenario.
It's a tricky deal here. So
here's the deal. You are not allowed.
Over what you can't do.
Well, let's first set the table here. Okay.
Okay, so set the table.
I am an optometrist in Tulsa. my company is Dr. Robert Zellner and Associates.
Okay.
And I have been in Tulsa for 25 years. And when people see me out to eat, when I go to restaurants, when my co-host goes with me, people go, oh, you're Dr. Z.
And that's your co-host.
And your co-host goes, that's the guy. I'm sitting next to the guy. And people always say nice things to you, but yet typically the average person who likes a service does not naturally go on Google and go, oh, wow, my glasses showed up on time. I know what I'll do. I'll take time out of my schedule to form an account and to write a Google review. So what happens is only the trolls are in control. So the troll says, well, I live with my mother. I don't have anything going on. I have no job. I know what I'll do. I'll go online and write a review.
My glasses came in one day later than they said.
I was fired for not doing my job, and so I've got a lot of time on my hands, and I'll write a review. I'm a competitor. I'm going to write a review. So what happens is the trolls are in control of reviews. So if you're listening right now, ask yourself, do you write reviews? Oh, but yet, do you read reviews? Oh. So the thing is, you have to incentivize people to want to write reviews, but Google says you cannot incentivize someone to write a positive review.
Oh,
so
now, whoa, back.
A little technicality there, right?
So here we go.
Speak slowly and use your words.
I cannot say, hypothetically, please, Thrive Time listeners, go to Dr. Robert Zellner and Associates and write a positive review. And if you do, I will give you a discount off of your glasses. I cannot say that.
You cannot say that.
The Google rules.
That's against the Google rules, and they make the rules because it's their game.
And here's what I could say, and this is what I am saying to you, the Thrivers, and not only a hypothetical scenario, but a real scenario. If you Google Dr. Zellner and Associates and the word Tulsa, and you find the Google map, And you'll write an honest review of how your last experience there. I will give you a copy of my newest book, Thrive, as a way to thank you for being transparent about your experience. Now, I can't tell you that you have to write something positive or negative, but if you'll just write something, I might just happen to give you a copy of my book to thank you for taking the time to be transparent. But I can't say you only get the book if you write the positive thing.
So that's important for everybody out there that has a business. That, I mean, getting Google positive Google reviews is obviously something that helps get you to the top of Google, that helps help sell your business. People look at them, obviously, but you can't tell people, listen, I'll reimburse you for writing a positive review. All you can do is say, listen, please get on, do an honest review. And you could, if you don't have to reimburse them, but you could give them something for that.
And then
that's a little subtle difference there, but you got to pay attention to that.
And you make it super, super easy for them, right? I know you want to send the actual link because if you're like me, you're on the interwebs, you don't know where to go. There's too many email addresses. Got to make a Google one. I have to, a separate one.
Broadcasting live from the center of the universe, you're listening to the Thrivetime Show.
But if you send a link to my email, I just click on it. I'm already at your right business address, and it's so easy. And that's going to probably also increase.
Ooh, nice.
So,
Z, call, Bird. Make it easy.
I have a question for you, Z. Okay, would you be impressed if you knew that one of the businesses I work with now has 101,000 Google reviews? Would you be impressed if you knew that information? Would you hypothetically, yet again, as we go down this hypothetical parallel universe?
It takes 102,000 for me to reach okay, the level of
please,
impressed.
Please.
No, that's very impressive. What? No, 101,000?
Yes, please use your Google. Please use your Google.
My
okay,
Google?
Okay, we'll wait for you. Drivers, we'll wait. We'll wait for you as well. Google carpet cleaning.
Carpet.
And then space, put a little space blank. Oxy Fresh. Carpet cleaning Oxy Fresh. I'll give you a moment. And once you find it, I want you to scroll down until you see Oxy Fresh. It should say carpet cleaning coupons, Oxy Fresh. You see the stars?
Mm-hmm.
You see them? And how many stars do we have today, my friend? Do you see those stars down there? Do you see that number? I know you're an optometrist. I know your vision is always 20/20 or even better than 20/20 if that's possible.
It's 4.6
and 101,000. 393 reviews.
Oh, so Oxy Fresh, that's a Tulsa guy. He went to Victory Christian Center, went to Oral Roberts University. He has systemically created a system, which we've worked with John for years. He's a guy we've been happy to work with, and he's actually a partner now with Elephant in the Room. And it's a way that after every experience, we prompt the customer to write a review, whether good or bad. We just want to know your feedback. And 101,000 customers have now done it. And you know what? Thrivers, that is ethical. But check it out. People don't want to write a review unless there is some kind of pressure. Like, why would you take time out of your schedule? If time is the one thing we cannot make more of, why would we ever want to take time out of our schedule? I mean, if you can make more money, but you can't make more time, if you have a finite amount of time on the planet, why would you ever take time out of your schedule to ever write a review? I mean, would you do it, Z? Why would you write a review?
Yeah, no, unless you're just really upset, and then, you're doing it.
You're reviewing all over the
place. I
bet
I wouldn't write
then.
A review. I would contact the company and try to work through there. I would never just throw out that kind of negative,
Vanessa, have you ever written a review on Google?
Only the companies that have nicely asked me to, and I have a fondness for them. Maybe I have a relationship with that company. And so that's what motivates me to do it because I love them.
So here's the deal, Thrivers. That's a kind of a positive pressure you'd want to apply. But I would encourage you. This is my move number one I give you. Move number one. I would encourage you to use humor and persistence to get Google reviews. So persistence meaning I would send them an email saying, hey, it would mean the world to me if you could share your feedback about your last experience with us. As you know, so many people read Google reviews, but so few people write them. It would mean the world to me if you would write a review. And I'd put a link right there in the email so they can just click the link and go right to the review source. Now, the second move I would do is I encourage you to use a little bit of humor. If someone hasn't written a review yet, call them up and go, hey, I was on Google and I noticed I don't see a review from you. I would love it if you'd write a review, or I just might toilet paper your house. No, I'm just kidding. But you want to have a little fun with it.
Well, when we come back, I'm going to give you another secret move in how to get reviews on your Google thing.
Stay tuned for the Google thing.
My name is Cody Reynolds, and I'm from Sepulpa, Oklahoma. I actually heard about it on the radio. I listened to talk radio, and I started listening to their show, and they were peddling the conference, and so they got me. learned that it is definitely not a scam. And I brought my brother with me, and after an hour of being here, he was fully convinced that it was, that this was an amazing thing. And we've learned how crucial certain aspects of business are, your website and your branding, and making sure you surround yourself with good people. It's invaluable, and it's the highest quality conference that you can go to for sure, and they will specifically target your needs and answer your questions, and they don't leave you in the dark about anything. It's cool. It's got a very good setup. The flow here is really nice. The ambiance is very cool. It's a place that you want to hang out at, and if you just wanted to stop by and hang out, it's like a place you could do that. It's very forward. It's to the point. It's humorous. It keeps your attention. It's very thorough too. Yeah, he definitely will ask questions. They remember who you are, your name, the business that you're there for, and they allow questions. They almost demand that you come up with questions, because that's the only way that they can help you with your specific goals. I think they're missing how doable a business is, and the positive attitude that that you need to bring. And also, I think they're missing the reality of how much work it is, and they're definitely missing the light at the end of the tunnel. We haven't been upsold anything since we've been here. They haven't tried to sell us food or drinks or some sort of web design, nothing. This conference is literally all about us and what we're trying to achieve, and it's obvious that they are passionate about what we're passionate about. I would say because it's because of their willingness to work with you, the name your price on the tickets, that they want you to bring your employees, your business partners, and just the amount of knowledge you can learn in just 2 days.
All right, welcome back to the Thrivetime Show on your radio dial. I'm telling you what, if you are looking for a show that has practical business tips that will definitely help you increase your income, today's show, if you apply the principles I'm teaching you today, I have one Thriver today that I've talked to, that met with him this morning at 7 a.m. inside the Thrive15.com world headquarters. I met this guy today. No exaggeration. He has tripled his income and is almost over $90,000 a year of income now, where last year he made $30,000 as a result of just the first tip we're teaching today. We're teaching you how to apply positive pressure when you ethically agree with the motive. But specifically, we're talking about how to gather reviews on the Google thing. Some of you have heard of Al Gore. You've heard of the Google. This is what we're talking about, Google reviews. If you ever Google a business and you've read the reviews, if you're looking for a restaurant, everybody here, if you're looking for a restaurant, a place to eat, what do? You Google the name of the company, you read reviews, and you decide whether it's a good thing. But do you write the reviews? Dr. Z, you have a tip for gathering reviews, my friend.
I know. Right before the break, I said I had a little hot sauce, a little Woo! Secret tip that I do.
So hot.
And this follows the Google rules, so pay attention. Listen closely. Don't think I'm saying something I'm not.
Okay.
But what I do is I tell my staff members is that when I'm looking through the Google reviews of the businesses, if I happen to find one, just happen to kind of see one, right? And it's a 5-star and it mentions their name specifically, I give them a bonus.
Now, I have an audio clip from a Thriver. He tried to call in. As soon as you said, he tried to call in. And Sam, our executive producer, he's like, listen, I'm trying to produce a show here. I can't let everyone just get through. He recorded the call. He's queued up the audio. Thank you, Sam, so much for doing that. Okay, so here we go.
Surely you can't be serious.
I am serious.
Coming in
and
hot.
Don't call me Shirley.
Okay, Z, so repeat that one more time.
Knock me down.
So I tell all my staff, I say, listen, we can't go out there and tell people to write positive reviews about us, but we can say, listen, if you had a good experience or if you had an experience, please get on and be honest and write a review of us. And if they happen to, if I happen to see it, that they have a 5-star review, which is the best you can do, boom.
Boom. Right,
and they mention your name specifically, that you went above and beyond. You did all the 5 A's that a great employee does, and you got mentioned in the review. I am going to take that as a sign that you need a bonus, and I'm going to give you one. A little financial reward.
Ooh.
Yeah. You know why I think that really works? Is because, you know, like I said, the companies that I've written reviews for, it's because it was motivated by a personal connection I felt with someone there. So if his employee, Bob, goes back and, you know, preps someone for their eyes or whatever, and they really connect with the client, and then Bob lets them know, hey, you know, just to let you know, if you get on and write a review, I would really appreciate it. That's great. They are going to be so much more willing to do it, not because of the company, but because they have this connection now with Bob, they feel. So I think it's such a great super move you have there.
Now, as far as Google reviews, I want to be clear. This is just, I'm trying to make sure we get all the details here, all the details. One, at our in-person workshops, we will teach you the canonized, the specific way to build your Google map properly. We'll teach you that. We'll show you the art of gathering reviews ethically. We will, but here's the thing is when you do solicit reviews, we had a thriver who attended our workshop, hysterical, but we asked him to write a review about the conference and his feedback. So his feedback focused entirely on the lack of accommodations that he perceived Tulsa to have, and he gave us a 4. So he's like, the conference was good, but the accommodations, oh my gosh, the hotels here just aren't up to par.
Which and aren't I'm, connected to us at all.
Right. You know? It's like, okay, yeah, sure. So I'm in charge of all the hotels in Tulsa. That makes sense.
I thought you were.
But he thought, no, Vanessa, did we not? We had dinner in Las Vegas with a guy who was a foodie.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. Oh, I love this guy.
And he refused to give the meal a 5-star.
He says he never gives them out.
Because he said that the dessert was kind of dry.
Well, and he says it can always be better. Even because Clay said, even if it was the best meal you ever had, would you give it a 5?
So, like example, like I saw Braveheart, and when I saw Braveheart, that's a 5-star.
Yes,
and that's a definite 5-star. That's like a whoo, Shawshank Redemption, boom.
But I mean, you're also someone who's a 5-star or a 0-star.
Oh yeah.
Broadcasting live from the center of the universe, you're listening to the Thrivetime Show.
So the other day, I go into a gas station in town. I won't mention it. I'll say it's not a quick trip. It was definitely not a quick trip. I'm being serious. This was not a quick trip.
I can't believe you went to something that was not a quick trip.
Well, it's by the house.
Like,
and
I
sometimes
don't even know
I go in. I know, but I go in there. It's because it's by the house. And it's sometimes.
All right.
So I pull over and I go in there and I go into the restroom and it's like a bomb went off. All of the things they show in those late night commercials going, if you don't donate this many dollars a day, this is what could happen. It was that whole commercial just running in the bathroom. It was like a frog had somehow grown from an amoeba into a rainforest, and it was just seepage and sewage and just nasty. It smelled like an undiscovered place. It was just not good. It was like the scene from Star Wars where Han Solo falls into that trash compactor with Princess Leia. It's weird. It smells weird.
A lot going on in there.
Yeah. So if I were to write a review of that place, I would go 0 across the board. Smells like a... What an unbelievable smell in that bathroom. Clean that beast. But I'm the kind of guy, because I own businesses, I do not ever write a review, ever, negative, ever, until I've talked to management and they've had an opportunity to correct it and they've refused to. That's my whole deal. So if I had a problem with any business ever, I'm being real, I've never done it. I would not ever do it. If I have a problem with a business, I will call up and ask to speak to a manager or somebody in charge. And if they have an opportunity to fix it, then they can. So who's the first person who hasn't made a mistake? Jesus? Who's number 2? It's a short list. So the thing is that I'm just telling you this. I have made mistakes in my companies. And I remember back in the day with the DJ connection, someone would call me after the wedding and say, hey, you know, we were very happy with the wedding. Great. Someone would call me and go, hey, you know, your guy, you know, the music wasn't, the song we queued up for our first dance started about 30 minutes after we thought it would, or there was a problem with a speaker or whatever. We always wanted to make it right. And when you try to make it right, that's all you can do is give the business owner a chance to do that. So I encourage you ethically, do not go out there and write negative reviews about someone until you've had a chance to talk to the management. Because otherwise, it's just sort of a...
And then you might get it remedied and not even have the problem anymore, actually.
Z, is that a pet peeve for you, people that complain without talking to management first?
Absolutely, and I would never do it either because, you know, we're in those shoes and we understand. You want the opportunity to fix it. You know, you really measure a company not when things go great.
Mm.
That's not the measure of a company. The measure of a company is when something goes wrong and then how they respond to it. And you've got to give them an opportunity to respond and not some of this, you know, trollish, you know, from a distance. I'm just going to do this, you know, review.
Just being transparent. My name is TulsaCritic at yahoo.com. I mean, so ambiguous. They hide behind that pseudo name.
Yeah. And you know, and then you, you they put a person's name down. You look it up, not even in your system. So you're like, I don't even know. This is just kind of jackassery, you know. But I was talking about when my employees, in order to get that 5-star review from a customer,
yep.
You know, there's the 5 A's that I coach them up on. If you own a business, or you're hiring people, or you're in management right now, and you're listening to this, and you're at lunch. Probably at Oklahoma Joe's.
That's where you probably are.
Burnt ends and baked beans. Chances are highly one of their 3 locations near the Bass Pro Shop in Broken Arrow, 61st and Sheridan, and next to the iconic Kane's Ballroom.
It's created a marital problem. I've now been living at the Oklahoma Joe's. I've been camping at the baked beans, and Vanessa's just saying, hey, you need to come home. You need to come back on. I'm like, they're open for another 30 minutes.
There's just a little bit more baked beans. But the 5 A's that I coach up my people are accuracy. You can write these down. Above and beyond. In other words, doing things above and beyond what their area dictates. Attendance, appearance, and attitude. And if they do all those 5 A's well, then they are in a position to ask the customer for that review. They can't say, listen, you know, I need a positive review, but they can sure say, hey, give me a review and be honest.
And we come back, we're going to talk about the dark art of closing deals. Some of you are like, sales is so unethical. Selling something, pressuring. It's like this next show. Some of you feel like, I got to turn it off. What's the show rated? And we're talking about sales on the show?
Close that deal.
Oh, wow. The weed in the word close, so negative. Stay tuned. Thrivetime Show.
My name is Travis Ryan. I'm from Claremore, Oklahoma, and I'm part of a precision calibration operating shop. So a few things that I've learned from the Thrive 15 workshop is definitely the importance of getting your online brand out there and getting the domination of the market and schedule. I would describe the overall atmosphere here at the Thrive 15 headquarters as, I mean, just full and rich of culture for sure, and doers and getting things done. I would describe the world headquarters as, I mean, it's almost like a walk through time. It's a walk through a vast amount of successful people and how they got there and the roadmap of the motivation to get you there as well. Clay's presentation and teaching style is very engaging. Keeps you on your seat, keeps you engaged. You know, you're always listening to every word, and leaves you for more. What people are missing that have never came to the Thrive 15 workshop, I mean, it's just the keys to business success without all the ups and downs that typically come with it. You know, I mean, you're really missing out on a good roadmap, you know, to get to where you want to go sooner than later. Here at the Thrive 15 conference, I definitely did not feel like you guys were trying to upsell or necessarily sell anything. That is definitely something that I don't like when I go to some of my real estate conferences and stuff that I go to in Vegas, you know, and a lot of times the whole agenda is just pressed on that rather than giving you what you're really there for. Other people should definitely check out the workshop if they're serious about being an entrepreneur. I mean, it's kind of like retirement. If you don't put money back, you're only hurting yourself in the future.
One, two, two into the three on the microphone. It is me, Clay Clark, the former SBA Entrepreneur of the Year, sent here to make your wallet persevere, to help you make more money than is normal, to make a copious amount of cash so you can buy whatever you want, maybe even spread some extra cash on the dash right there, Z. That's the whole point of today's show.
Those rhymes.
Is to help you make it the more money. Make it the more the money.
Well, that's why we are the number one rated business talk show in the Tulsa Green Country area right now.
True.
Because we are giving practical business knowledge, not just, you can, you know what, just do it. Just chase your dreams and make it just, you know, just fire it up and get it on.
It's all about your passion.
You know, walk on the coals
of
life.
Here's the deal.
Your why.
Crush defeat and rise up victoriously.
I want to tell
giving you.
We're
practical steps.
No, we want to talk about, there's 3 things I want to talk about.
Okay.
One is you got to find your passion.
Sure.
Two, you got to find something that, you got to find your why, which is the why behind, you got to peel back the onion of motivation.
Once you know the why, it's all done basically, right?
Well, the third thing is you got to find a way to leverage your connections and to replicate.
Okay, that's a good show right there. That'll sell. I tell you, as I'm eating lunch, I just got to, you know what, I'm sitting here eating my sandwich. And I look over at my buddy in the cubicle next to me, and I think, I wonder if he has his why.
I wonder. No, this is the practical show.
It's a practical show. We're giving you practical steps because I tell you what, in the box that rocks with me, I'm not kidding you, Thrive Nation out there. I have to my right now. Used to be to my left, but to my left, I just have a wall. But to my right, I have a gentleman who is the world, and I will stand behind this. Till the day I die, the world's best business coach. This dude is business coach on like steroids. It's like if you took a lot of steroids and business stuff and you pumped it into a dude,
put it in his mind,
and made him robotic. You would end up with Clay Clark. So.
That's why I have such acne flare-ups and why I'm always freaking out. You know, just all the steroids. Okay, no, but seriously, Thrivers, we are honored to be here with you. And today we're talking about how to apply pressure when you agree with the motive. And specifically, this motive is closing more deals, which allegedly, when you make money, you can spend it on goods and services that you would like. And so closing deals, this is what I see all the time. There's three issues I'm going to unpack them for you as it relates to closing deals.
Right. Let's unpack them.
You're meeting with a prospect, mm-hmm. and you know that your product is the best.
Yes.
And they say, well, I'm going to think about it. I'm going to compare you versus the other guys. That's the one. So it's compare you versus the other guys.
The compare game, yes, yes. They're buying time by doing the whole, yeah.
Scenario number two is somebody asks you directly, what do you do? Right? They just ask you, what do you do? They're not even comparing you. They just say, what do you do? I mean, you're a fence builder. And you just you run into someone at a Chamber of Commerce event and they go, well, what do you do? And how do you convey that in a persuasive way? And the third element I see with closing deals is indicating some sense of time pressure so that you actually get paid before you pass away, right? You want to make some money. You want to close a deal before you die, right? You want to make some money. You don't want to just have those deals that are drifting and drifting. So, see, I want to ask you, if you're going face-to-face with it's you versus another optometrist, hypothetically, and the patient says, you know, I'm thinking about using Dr. Zellner and Associates, or I'm going to use blah, 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 some national, you know, company that you could find hypothetically in a mall somewhere. Okay. So if you're sitting down with the patient and I just ask you, I put you on the spot and I say, well, you know, I like what we see here, Dr. Z, but, you know, I mean, we're looking at maybe going to the mall and finding a different, you know, national, we've looked at a different company. You know, I just don't know. How would you respond to that?
Well, I would respond to that. If they're in my office, and yep. they already got an eye exam, or they've got an eye exam. Now they're about purchasing their glasses.
Yeah, and they're thinking about maybe going somewhere else to get a better deal, they think.
Right. Okay. So what I would do is I would say, well, we've taken the mystery out of it for you. We've done the shopping, and here are the numbers and how we beat the competition price-wise. But that's not what it's all about. We also have a guarantee, a free frame warranty that we stand behind our frames for 2 years. And so we have not only the best price, but we also have our guarantee. And then we also make them right here in-house with our high-end, high-tech lab. So you really get the best of everything right here. There's really no need to go anywhere else.
But you would not have a problem saying that your company's better than the other guys.
Not at all. Otherwise, if I don't believe it, who else is going
to
believe it?
And it's up to you to make it the best, right?
Absolutely.
Yeah.
So this is the thing. This is what I do. And I encourage all the Thrivers to do it. Vanessa, you've seen me do this.
Yep.
I will research the competition and I will make a spreadsheet of everything that they do well. And then I will try to beat them on as many of the variables as possible. So when I'm sitting in front of a bride, I remember with DJ Connection back in the day, this happened every single wedding except for Shannon and Clark's wedding.
Shannon? I know specifically who you were talking about, and it broke your soul.
It's the only wedding, Z, I did not book at all during the Broken Arrow Brigade. We were there in Broken Arrow for 3 years, the only person ever.
And it was not because of anything that we did, and they actually ended up, from what we heard, kind of regretting that decision.
Here's the deal. I'm sitting there talking to them, and they go, how do you stack up versus this company? And I know. I said, well, first off, they're going to give you 4 hours of DJs. With DJConnection.com, you get unlimited time. But with the other guy, you get 4 hours. Two, any music that you want, if we don't have it, we'll get it for you. Three, we'll work as the host to host the event, to lead the way, to plan the event. We're not going to just be a bystander. We're going to help lead the way. 4, we do professional sound and lights. 5, we have a guarantee. So if you're not happy, you get all your money back. And so I would like to give you a list of references you can read through. And I'm going to go upstairs real quick and prepare all the paperwork, but you guys can keep this. It's the cell phone numbers of about 100 brides we've worked with. You can give the brides and grooms a call, and we'll come back in a minute. I come downstairs. It only happened one time. And I said, so do you guys want to go ahead and move forward? Which package makes sense to you? And they go, we're going to go with someone else. And I remember going, what? And I remember looking at him, and he goes, you don't have to get, like, offended. I mean, I remember my face was visually like an explosion. I'm like, ha, this never happened. And he goes, no, we've heard some things. And I said, well, who did you hear from? Well,
from
you know,
competition.
Just some things. Well, the competition sat there and told them. They go, I will promise you, you want to use anybody but DJ Connection.
Yeah.
By that point, they were all, the competition had like amassed together to try
what
to
what was awesome is all of them combined were still doing less than half that we were doing. We had, my friends, this thing called market share. But doing the research gives you that confidence to close those deals. Now, the second deal is you're in front of somebody and you've worked so hard. You've been to a networking event. You've gone to a chamber. You've had a breakfast with pineapple. Remember those breakfast networking events, Z, with the pineapple?
Yes.
When you're first starting a business, that's the move. You go to those events, and you're like, you have a pineapple, and there's a guy who goes, in just a minute, we're going to say the Pledge of Allegiance, and then we are going to, and then some guy gets up, now we're going to recognize the senator from the state of, and then it's like all these formalities, and then they go, and now for the next 10 minutes, we're going to put 10 minutes on the clock, and you all get to network, okay? So you get to tell, you get to stand up, tell people what you do, exchange cards now, 10 minutes on the clock, and then he goes.
It's hard for me to picture either of you two at that kind of event. He's like, you just don't have time for it. You're like, what are we doing?
How I started. This was my move. I mean, I bought that membership from Marianne Rule at the Chamber. I saw her at Brahms the other day, by the way. Marianne, if you're listening, if you know Marianne, send her a text, okay? But anyway, so I bought that membership, and I'm like, hell or high water, this thing's going to pay for itself. So you get in front of someone, they go, so what do you do, right? And you know that you do what they need. Z, you need to have an elevator pitch. You need to have an elevator pitch. Why?
Well, because what'll happen is that you'll get that opportunity. You don't want to blow it. And you can come across as, in those settings, you can come across as too forceful and too, and they'll turn you off. But if you give them enough to where they go, what is that? What do you do? They're curious. You kind of bait them. You got to fish a little bit for them. You know, you don't want to snag them. You want them to bite your bait.
So give us an example of kind of the teaser, kind of the teaser move that kind of snags the bait.
Okay, so let's say you sell life insurance, and if you go up to a group like that, and you're sitting there and you're eating your pineapple upside down cake or whatever it is that you're doing at the thing. Yeah, at the thing, and someone looks at you and then let's say, well, what do you do? And you look at them and you go, I sell life insurance. You pretty much are going to just kind of get shut down the rest of the lunch. And
that goes over about as well as taking all your clothes off and streaking through the breakfast.
Let's go streaking.
That leaves a bigger impact.
Yeah.
But if you say, if they look at you and they say, what do you do? And you say, I make dreams come true.
What do you do?
I make dreams come true.
How so?
Do you have any dreams?
Yeah.
Well, what would be a dream, a financial dream that you would have?
I think just being able to retire, you know, debt-free, financially free.
Well, I'm that's what I do. I make dreams like that, happen.
So,
now you're hooked. Now you're like,
he's wooing them. That's what he's doing. Instead of just like telling them and then the date shuts them down, he's giving us a little bit.
I'm jigging my little plastic worm out there. I'm not trying to snag them. And then they're like, now they're involved. Now they're thinking about the dreams they have. Now they're thinking, well, I've always wanted a beach house. I've got a dream. I've always wanted a beach house. Really? Where would you like for that to be? All of a sudden now you're developing the need for someone to come in with financial services to help you see all those things come true. So that's an example.
It kind of ties into that whole psychological pattern of people want what they can't have. People want to know more, but you have to have an elevator pitch. Now we come back. We're going to talk about it with the situation of how you close the deal. When you know what you have is clearly what the other person wants, how do you close that deal, Z?
Can I give my 12 commandments on closing a deal?
Are you serious?
Yeah.
12 commandments?
12 commandments. One
show?
You don't want to miss it.
I can't believe it. No, give it to me now. Give it to me now.
Nope, not going to do it.
All right, stay tuned. ThriveTimeShow.com. Sign up for the next conference. We want to see you there. ThriveTimeShow.com.
I'm Lori Crow. I'm from Broken Arrow, Oklahoma, and I'm thinking about doing my own business promotions, marketing, advertising for companies. I heard about Thrive, one, by Googling online, and then two, the radio show, and then I've been an avid listener ever since. I've learned a ton. I've learned about setting your own schedule and making sure that the business is going to serve you first. I've learned about the accounting part, the SEO optimization, branding, marketing. I've learned more in the last 2 days than I have the entire 4 years of college. The environment is awesome. It's totally creative. If you're into just thinking and being open, it's inspiring. Everyone here is friendly. Everyone goes above and beyond. It's just service oriented, and it's also creative, and it just gives you a chance to seek and, I think, be more, dream more, and believe more. You have to come out and see it. It's worth the trip. And also, I just think you owe it to yourself. If you're going to be in business for yourself, you need to come here. This is the school to come to. Clay's presentation and speaking style is honest, forthright, and he's hilarious. So it's a comedy show mixed in with nuggets of truth and actually really, really good advice. Common sense and actually nuggets of good advice. It's very interactive. He asks you questions. You get to answer questions. It's set up just as a group, and there's no right or wrong answer. It's just being real and really getting to the nitty-gritty of it. I think they're missing everything. I think if anyone's struggling to start a business, or they're going to have their business, or you have any problems, you're missing it, because you're not going to find the answers online on tutorials or Instagram ads or videos. You have to come and actually just immerse yourself in a school such as this from beginning steps 1 all the way through 14. You have to immerse yourself. It's completely different, because at the very end, actually starting in the middle to the end, I was asking, what more can I buy? What more can I get into? What do you have? Books? Do you have classes? What else can I take? So it was actually reverse. It left me wanting more and not feeling like I'm being scuttled to the back of a room to sign up now, and that urgent pressure that everyone hates. I think everyone should check it out. It is one of the best things. I'm going to be a walking billboard for them, because everybody needs this. Everyone tells you how to start a business, but nobody's really giving you the practical steps to do it, and this does it. Dreaming about the
things we could be, baby. All right, Thrive Nation, welcome back into the conversation. It is the Thrive Time Show on the radio. My name is Clay Clark, and I'm joined here with Tulsa's business hero. It's Dr. Robert Zellner. Sir, how are you?
I am fantastic. You know, we have a great topic on today's show, and it's all about you as a manager, you as a boss, you as the business owner. How do you get the people around you to do the things that you need them to do? I.e., you know, we said earlier, put pressure on them, motivate them, inspire them, educate them to do the things
threaten
that you need
them.
Force them, as you said earlier. And so that's kind of what we're handling today. And it's very practical stuff.
Well, I wrote down some notable quotables that we're not going to teach on today's program. Okay. And because we have Phil, Dr. Phil, he's America's number one financial planner here. He's kind of a Tulsa living legend here of some kind. He's with Anchor Financial. Phil, for anybody who's just now tuning in, who are you and what do you do, my friend?
Well, I am Phil Pickle, and I have the Anchor Financial Group, and we do a lot of financial services for business owners and individuals, as well as some cost recovery programs that I would like to get into a little bit today later.
Now, rumor has it it's your birthday today. Is this correct?
That's a rumor. Everybody knows about your birthday anymore. I can't get it off Facebook.
We weren't sure what to get you, so we got you a jar of pickles. You'll see on my desk here. This is not just it's got your name, Phil Pickle.
Right.
I spent about 4 or 5 hours going over this idea, really, and then Z spent about 3 or 4 minutes validating the idea. And so, really, it's 4 hours and 3 minutes of our life we're giving to you in that pickle jar.
Awesome.
So I'm going to read you my notable quotable that I would like to use as it relates to persuasion before Z gets into his 12 tips. So Phil, I'm going to read it to you, and you tell me whether you agree with this motivational tip.
Okay.
Z told me I can't read it on the air, but I'm going for it. Here we go, Z. Here we go.
I
This is motivational tip number one. I wanted to print these on the Thrive shirts for the office, and then Z's like, you can't do that. But here it is. Where there's a whip, there's a way.
That's true. Yes.
So what's your need? Do you think it'll catch on? If this is a management shirt, you can begin. I mean, if you worked at Chevron, could you see the HR director wearing the shirt that says, where there's a whip, there's a way?
Yeah, maybe. It's not a jar of pickles, but
Okay. That's my one notable quote. I'll have some more later on. But see, let's get into the 12 moves.
Commandments of closing, because we're talking about closing the deal. And we're talking about how you can motivate, educate, and put pressure on your people to do it. And part of what you need to do is, you can't just say to them, one thing you can't do, or I mean, you can do it, but it will not get good results, is to sit down your sales team and say, guys, we got to be closing more deals. Just got there and close them.
You can't just yell at them and
you
tell
just,
them.
You just close them. They're like looking at you. You're like, just close those deals or else. They're like, you can do that, but it's much better to say, hey, listen, here's some steps, some helpful steps in closing deals. Mm. I'm going to call them my 12 commandments.
Okay, I'm ready. I'm ready. Okay.
So you give the presentation standing up, but then once you start the negotiations, you sit down.
You sit down when closing the deal?
You remain seated. Even if they get up, you don't stand up. Because what will happen is if they get up and you stand up, then that's kind of a change in transition. You can let them squirrel off. So stay seated and remain calm. You've done this in DJ Connection.
Yeah.
No, yeah. You just.
Yeah. Okay. Well, Phil, I want to get your take on this, too. You know, I've discovered through my career and read through sales books is he who speaks first loses. So the idea is if you're sitting down with a customer and you believe in your product and you've laid out the plan for them or laid out the product and you say, well, hey, did you want to get started on this day or that day? Or do you want to sign here or there? I mean,
you want to pay with credit or debit, then you sit there.
Now, I want to ask you this, Phil. When you're talking to somebody helping, you know, lay out their financial future and you've laid out a plan and they feel good about it and you feel good about it, what about the listener who feels almost like they don't want to pressure someone, they don't want to feel embarrassed to ask for the deal? What advice would you have for the Thriver listening who's like, I just feel that part is so stressful asking for the deal?
Well, and that's what you do is you just kind of wait for them to respond. And usually in my situation, they're so ecstatic that they have to come down and you know realize that hey, this is a great deal, but I need to focus and get this done.
Mm.
So yeah. It's definitely a sense of urgency that you have to create, but you don't have to create it by pressuring them to sign the paper.
I want to ask you this here, Phil. I want to ask this real quick. So you do, you know, some of the products you do, and you obviously do financial planning with people. One of the ones you do is an asset valuation. Is that right? Asset
that is correct.
Valuation analysis. What does that mean?
Well, that's basically, on an individual sense, it's basically taking what they have now
mm-hmm.
and putting together a plan of where they need to be for retirement.
Yeah.
And seeing how far they've gotten, and then devising a plan to get them where they need to go.
So you're saying once you've sat down with somebody and helped them laid out their financial future, they're pretty ecstatic about it.
Right.
So just right. At that point, it's just asking for the deal, right?
Right. Yeah. I mean, it's basically I'm going to show them the roadmap how to get there.
Okay.
And that's exciting in itself for a lot of folks because they don't know how to get a real retirement going. They don't know what they need. You know, they had somebody tell them, hey, put $100 a month into a 401k plan and your retirement's taken care of. Well, that's not the case. So we show them the actual roadmap. They're excited about the programs that we have to get them there. And it's just up to them to implement.
Now, Z, what's the next move?
Well, you've covered several of these right there when you guys' conversation. So the second one is you always want to do a proposal in writing. People Oof. Don't always, they hear a lot of things during the day. So if you can give it to them in writing, it carries much more weight when you're getting ready to close a deal.
Well, I know when you're working with Phil, and Phil, for anybody who doesn't know who you guys are or how to get a hold of you, what's your website? What's your phone number?
We are myanchorgroup.com is our website. Phone number is 918-591-2880.
And if I'm listening right now and I'm trying to listen to you while having Oklahoma Joe's, I got a lot going on here. I'm trying to eat my Oklahoma Joe's, trying to have my baked beans while also listening to the show here. At the end of the day, I mean, you're a financial planner. Is this correct?
That is correct.
Okay. And so you, when you make a plan, I mean, when you just say, hey, we're going to invest in these particular financial advice, you know, whether it's like an annuity or a mutual fund or these particular financial products, why do you want to have something in writing and not just, you know, a bunch of hyperbole that you're speaking verbally? Why do you want, for anybody listening right now who's struggling with the idea of why they need to write down something specific, why would you advise to do that?
Well, first of all, anytime anybody talks about putting goals together, and that's what we're doing in a lot of cases, you always want to write down those goals so you can review them. It helps the client understand what we're going with. And then after the meeting, they can go back and review what we had written down and what we showed them. Because, you know, they don't always catch everything the first time they talk with me. Sometimes they don't catch it the 10th time they talk to me. But they'll have the notes and they'll have the proposal to review. And, you know, that's critical.
Here's a motivational shirt for applying sales pressure, Z, that you also did not let me print.
Yeah, what was
it? But the shirt said, the pros go slow and only a goes fast. It says, the pros go slow and only a boop goes fast.
Yeah, I didn't let you print that one either.
But the thing is, honestly, when you talk super fast at your sales prospect and nothing's written down, you get known as a fast talker, a scammer, a whatever you insert the blank. And no one wants to be sold to that way.
Nobody wants to be sold that way. And that goes into my number, step number three, communicate clearly.
Oof.
You know, you want to be able to, you don't want to talk quickly, but you want to talk efficiently. You want to be able to tell your business story in less than a minute. You want to be able to, you know, summarize and get to the point quickly. That doesn't mean, you know, you talk real slow and just take forever. Nobody wants that. But you have to be efficient, but you have to communicate clearly.
So I'll give an example. When we would sit down with brides and grooms at DJ Connection, and they would say, we'd say, well, how familiar are you with our company? And they would say, well, I've kind of heard a little bit about you. You'd say, how familiar are you with the industry? And then we had a questionnaire. We would ask them about their wedding. But then when we would get into conveying what we do, I would say, there's five things that DJ Connection does that nobody else does. One, we have unlimited time, which means we'll be out there till 2 in the morning if your grandma wants to, or we'll wrap it up at 10 p.m., whatever you guys want. Two, any music you want, we'll go and get that for you, except for Michael Bolton. We just don't play it for safety concerns.
Oh, you do too play Michael Bolton.
And so we would go through and we would speak to them in it with energy, but we weren't talking like the Micro Machine guy going 90 miles an hour, going blah, 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 blah. It wasn't like an auctioneer at one of your auctions. It wasn't that fast. Phil, why is it so important when engaging with a financial planner that, or when you work with clients, why is it so important from your perspective to speak slowly and, you know, communicate clearly?
Well, it comes back to them understanding, you know, what you're saying and letting it sink in and not just talking over them and talking too fast and them not getting a clear picture, because this is serious stuff. This is we're sitting down talking to them about having a real retirement, not a survivorment, a retirement.
Not a survivorment. Now, Phil, I want to ask you, because one of the things you have that's a serious product for people is you have this group cost recovery program. Talk to me. What does that mean? Give me the clear. What is it, man? I mean, what is it? I'm listening to the show. This is your opportunity. You tell me about this product.
Well, basically what this is, and we've worked with businesses for several years on, you know, their 401k plans, their group health insurance, so financial and insurance products, where we try to go in and we try to give them a good deal, get a retirement plan started, or we try to save them money on their premiums. Well, we've come across another program, and it's a cost recovery program for businesses. It basically puts businesses or money back in the business's pocket. On things that they're already doing that they're not even aware they're eligible for.
How are you doing this?
Well, the one of the big parts is the cost segregation part, and it's basically an engineer-based study that looks at their real estate, commercial real estate, and reclassifies it and gets accelerated depreciation. And this one, I mean, it helps 9 out of 10 businesses out there, commercial property owners. And so it's a big one, and pick your industry, but hotels, for instance, on average, we're putting $240,000 back into the business owner's pockets.
So real quick, so just so we're getting this, if I'm listening right now, let's say that I have a commercial property, you could look at it and see that perhaps with new laws, new legislation, there's a way to reclassify the way that the property is zoned, the way that it's treated, the way it can be classified on your taxes. So if someone who's kind of new to the term of depreciation, you could essentially devalue or write off the value of the property faster and actually put cash in the pocket of the owner?
That is correct.
So you're kind of like the Santa Claus.
Exactly.
I kind of like this, Z. What's the next move, Z?
Well, the next one's a little sound self-evident, but, you know, it's something that doesn't come natural to a lot of people, and sometimes you have to practice it, but it's make eye contact.
Oh, that's
very, very important.
That is very stressful for somebody who's never done it before. You're really good at that.
Because I've practiced a lot, and I know it's important.
And I've seen you do this in uncomfortable situations when you're in a meeting and the things aren't going well. I've seen you look at everybody in the eye and kind of galvanize everybody around a common goal, or you're able to. No, but seriously, so many managers, when things get tough, that's when they won't make eye contact.
Right.
So encourage the thriver out there, or tell them what to do if they're struggling with eye contact. What's the move?
You've got to practice. I know it sounds weird, and you can't just practice on yourself. You got to get somebody, as weird as it sounds, and have a communication with them. And every time that they catch you not looking in their eyes, they get to reach up and pop you.
You know how I practiced? I'm a Judeo-Christian, so I went around the mall trying to convert people, just looking them in the eye for hours.
Just staring them
down.
No,
I didn't try that, but that might be a move.
That's not creepy at all. That's not creepy at all.
That might be a move. That might be a move that we don't endorse, but it could be a move. Z, what's the next move?
You just got to practice it. You know, always, and I know this sounds silly, but you always got to have a pen. You want to close the deal, you want to seal the deal, and then all of a sudden, You don't have a pin on you.
The power of the pin.
I know it sounds crazy, but you always make sure you got that pin. Pin for the deal. You got to do the deal.
The pin is great because the pin, you know, the mind will forget, but the pin does not. And when we get back, Phil's going to be kind of talking to us because he's helped major companies, major owners, business people throughout Tulsa plan a very secure financial future. And he's been doing this for years. And he's going to talk to us about how to persuade people, how to show people the evidence to show that your product is truly what people need. It's incredible. And I'm telling you what, drivers, you definitely want to come out to one of our in-person workshops if you are struggling at all with sales. Because when you can't sell, your business will go to Hades. So go to ThriveTimeShow.com. Again, go to ThriveTimeShow.com. And Z, there they can learn more about our in-person two-day business workshops, my man.
You come out to the workshop. The next one's going to be March 24, 25, and you get your own personal boom book. If you're looking on Facebook Live, here's an actual copy of it. It has the 13 steps. We go through them all, and it's awesome.
It is the world's best business workshop. Check out the reviews. That's ThriveTime Workshop. Go to ThriveTimeShow.com to learn more.
My name's Scott Crow. I'm from Broken Arrow, Oklahoma, and I'm actually considering being an entrepreneur. I don't have a business at this time. As far as just the system that Clay has applied in his businesses and how anybody can put it in place regardless of what they do as an entrepreneur. If they're a painter, make dog leashes, whatever it may be, it's very applicable. I would say that it's very opening and inviting. There's good information. You can get what you need out of it. There's no follow-up steps. If you're listening and taking notes and read through the material, there's good concrete information that you can apply to your business. Engaging. He verifies through the process that you understand what's been shared. He tracks and measures through each one of the sessions to make sure there aren't any unanswered questions about the topics that were discussed. Well, it's difficult to start a business, and I've never done that, and I'm considering that, but there's a lot of things that you have to understand, and it's great to hear from somebody that's already made the mistakes, which he shares a lot about how to do it now because he's made the mistakes. And so if you're considering starting a business, you're going to be equipped with a lot of tools that have taken other people years to learn. Well, the conference itself is to equip you with information at the conference. There's no add-ons in order to get the information that they share at that point in time. There's no push for that. You do have the ability to gain from some of the other tools and memberships after the fact, but you receive everything that you were told you were going to receive when you came to the conference and are equipped with those things. If you're considering starting a business or considering a business, you're going to be able to, I use the economy of scale. Once again, somebody's already done this. You're going to be able to hear the stories, how to go about things, so that if you really are serious about starting a business, you'll be given a roadmap to do that.
If you've ever worn roller skates, quad skates, you ever been to Roller City, you ever gone to that snack bar back in the 80s and bought yourself a big pickle, your mom and dad dropped you off at that roller skating rink with like $5, you had $5, you played Galaga, you played pinball. This song goes out to you. It's the Thrivetime Show on your radio, the special roller skating quad skate edition. Back in the day when denim was the standard. Z, do you remember that time?
Oh, yes. I'm 52 years old. Of course I remember that. That was back in the heydays. I mean, that was back in the good old days when you wore denim on top of denim.
I want to ask you this, Phil Pickle here with Anchor Financial Group. Phil, how old are you at this point, my friend? How old are you right now?
I am 47 years old today.
So 47, do you remember going to roller skating parties? Did you ever do that?
I did in grade school.
Did you ever go to elementary school around this area? Or where did you go to school?
No, I actually grew up in Missouri.
In Missouri?
Yeah, West Plains, Missouri, around that area.
Was that area big into roller? I mean, was roller skating big there as well?
It was. Smaller town, so we had the roller skating rink, and that's where everybody went on Thursdays.
My entire elementary experience while going to Linwood Elementary in Broken Arrow was waiting to know if they were going to serve tater tots for lunch. And if the skating party was going to be this Friday, because if there was, I would go out there skating horribly, hugging the sidewall, waiting for that couple skate.
Oh, yeah.
And I knew how to skate backwards just well enough that I could find a girl, usually a girl named Ashley or an Amanda, somebody with that 80s kind of a name.
Oh,
and
yeah.
I could get them to dance with me under the black light special. It was an incredible time in American history. I'm thankful for Linwood Elementary and for the gift of the quad skates, Z, as we talk about high-pressure persuasion. I'm just trying to persuade Tulsa to go roller skating.
And why not? And
I mean, it's a great usage of time.
It's a great exercise. Full body workout, works the core. Oh. Sam, the lumberjack over here, our producer, probably skates all the time, I would imagine.
That's all he's doing. I mean, he's got 40 hours a week booked just for roller skating.
Just for roller skating. Well, we're on step number 6 of the 12 closing commandments.
Oof.
And this is one that we use here on the show, matter of fact.
Okay.
And that is using humor.
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 You know, actually, who invented this actual move? Do you invent it?
Who invented it?
Hugh Morris.
Hugh Morris.
There we go. Yes.
I was waiting on that.
That took me about, that was 4 hours to choose Phil's birthday gift, the jarred pickles. 4 more hours for that joke. That's 8 hours of my life just I've invested in those awful jokes. It'll get funnier later, Thrivers. It's too early to get inebriated, but I'm telling you, it'll get funnier over time.
It's crazy.
Okay, so humor, this is the thing about humor, is humor creates likability, and people buy from people they like and trust.
Well, you said it just so well earlier. You said we play, you know, you're going through your DJ connection. You have a little bride and her man-to-be sitting in front of you, and you're doing your deal. You're closing the deal on them, and you use it right then. You said, we'll play any kind of music you want except Michael Bolton.
I'll tell you why that was so funny, because the mother of the bride came to plan a wedding, and it's not the bride's wedding. No. The mother of the bride is there to plan her wedding, and everything that she wanted to have happen at her wedding that was not done, she's going to make sure it gets done.
Oh, yeah.
And so the bride's kind of rolling her eyes, and the mother of the bride back in the day was always trying to weasel in a Michael Bolton song here or there. And so when I say we'll get any music you want except for Michael Bolton, it was funny to the bride who was driving in a station wagon with the mom who wanted to play Michael Bolton.
Oh, yeah.
And it was funny for the mom because the mom wanted to play Michael Bolton, and it was a conversation I knew they had, and they're like,
oh, yeah.
Oh, it's so true.
It's so true.
So, Phil, I want to ask you, you're a master financial planner there. For anybody who's new to the station, what is your website? How can people find out more about your financial planning company?
It's myanchorgroup.com is our website, and you can go there and go under the financial services tab and see all that you would want to see.
And you're kind of, I wouldn't describe you as a funny man, like, oh, this is Jim Carrey, he's a funny guy, boom. But you're a man who appreciates humor.
Right,
you make people laugh.
Right.
You're kind of a little jokester there. Why is humor so important when you're connecting with people?
It just puts people at ease, and it also makes you come across as a person. You know, and we believe that we want to get our clients to know us, like us, and trust us before we ever do business with them. And I know that helps a lot. That's one of the reasons why we do the cost recovery program. If I can get in with the business owner and put money back in his pocket first thing, before I ever really even start talking about products or anything else that I can do for him, before I show him the full scope, you've already put money back in his pocket. That relationship's off to a good start.
But you can't get the appointment. You know you can help people, but unless you're meeting with them, you can't help them.
Right.
And so that humor sort of kind of tills the soil to get in there. If you're listening right now and you're struggling to script out humor or to discover humor, one, I would recommend the book called Born Standing Up by Steve Martin, where he documents his journey to finding humor. And I would also encourage you that there are 5 things that are funny, and that's all we have as a human race. One is a thing called the joke. And I am not good at telling jokes, but we've all met someone who is.
Morse.
And half of the selling the joke is the what you do after you sell the joke.
Yeah, the timing, the inflection, the whole thing.
We had a guy who came into our office here a few months ago, and he goes, hey, guys, how are you guys doing? And we have a bar at the office, and I said, great. He goes, I got a joke for you. I said, what's the joke? He goes, well, the other day, two guys walked into the bar, and they both said, ouch. But the way he did it, like the way he sold it afterwards, you get it, and everyone's kind of, and I'm like, he just made something that really wasn't funny, but he's good at selling the joke.
Yeah.
So if you're a joke seller, be a joke teller. Move number 2 is random. A lot of times when you mix things that don't fit together, it just is funny. So a lot of times if you compare 2 unlike things, it's funny. That's why Steve Martin came out on stage wearing rabbit ears in a white suit, because it's like, why does a man have rabbit ears on when he's going to do his comedy tour? It doesn't make a lot of sense. Third move is shock. I don't have time to get into shock, but shocking is always a funny thing. That's why Will Ferrell naked in movies is always funny.
Always funny.
The fourth thing is stories. You have a great story that yes, kind of ends in a funny way. And the fifth is physical comedy. And I would encourage you to figure out what is funny, because we all know what funny isn't. But when you find something that's funny, that could be the first step in a great sales career for you. Z, what's the next move?
Well, the other thing, too, is that you always want to try to use really big words because that'll make you sound more photosynthesis. Okay, the other one, this is another thing that you are an expert at, Clay, and that is when you get to know.
Ooh.
How to ask one more time, all the moves. You know, go through all the little moves. You got your wounded dog. You got all your different moves you've done. So let's say you're closing the deal, yep, and you get that no. How do you ask one more time? How do you do that?
Well, move number one, get out to the in-person Thrivetime workshops, because there I will teach you a half-hour training on how to overcome every single sales objection that has ever been presented on the planet Earth. It is awesome. But the system is called the Deal Wheel. And here are the four parts of the deal wheel.
I love the deal wheel.
Step number one, you always want to go, and you want to make that sound, and that sound makes the other person go, oh. And so this
we need some deal wheel music.
So here's what you do.
This
you
is
go.
Be. This is the deal wheel music. Here.
Tell me I'm not interested.
I'm not interested. No.
So what do you mean by that?
It means I don't want to buy today.
So let me ask you this. What's the major cause? I mean, assuming all the companies charge the same price, what's the number one reason that you just don't want to move forward today?
I don't think I'm ready to commit.
Okay. Well, you know what we found is that a lot of the people we work with today once felt exactly the same way that you feel now. And what they found is by using our service, they're able to improve XYZ, 1, 2, 3, give you a bunch of facts, testimonials, which package seems best. Boom, turn around. It works every time.
Boom.
It's a ninja move. Now, Thrivers, I'm telling you what, we will teach you the in-depth intricacies of the deal wheel. We'll teach you that at our in-person workshop.
We got more deal wheel to come, but when we come back, you haven't done all your deal wheel moves on me.
Go to ThriveTimeShow.com. Get registered for our next in-person workshop. We'll see you soon. Stay tuned.
I'm Sam Parker.
Okay. I'm Karina Parker.
We live here in town.
We're looking to be in the food industry. Thrivetime workshops, we've learned about advertising and what we need to do to get our name out there, what we need to do to get to the top of Google, the necessary steps that we need to take right now to get to where we want to be.
The Thrivetime workshop experience is really encouraging, and it's great hands-on information and stuff that we can relate to, because we're able to talk to people here that are going through the same stuff that we are.
There's motivation everywhere. If you don't feel motivated, then something's wrong with you.
He's very upbeat.
All over the walls.
Yeah. He's very funny, like a comedian, but at the same time, he wants you to learn. And so if you have any questions, he's willing to help you and talk you through any questions that you have, but at the same time, making it fun and encouraging for you.
He's also very candid. He doesn't hold anything back that most people are like, ooh, maybe I shouldn't say that because it's offensive.
Yeah, you can tell he's being
real. He doesn't care about offending people.
Yeah, he just wants to help you.
So I heard an advertisement that said to leave your wallet at home. And, I mean, that's what it's been the whole time. It hasn't been like, oh, make sure you stop by our table in the back and buy 10 books and sign up for a 2-year subscription with us. It was just like, hey, you know, what we do offer, there wasn't pressure, and it's a month-to-month thing. It's not like you're signing your life away.
If you are listening to the show because you were born in this great country, if you're listening to this show because you've moved into this country, if you are listening to this show because somehow your radio is stuck on this station in this country and you can't turn it off, you can't mute it, either way, we welcome you into the Thrivetime Show, where our entire focus is helping you to improve your level of financial and time freedom. If you were born in this USA, you are so fortunate to be here. It's kind of like you've won the genetic lottery when you're in the United States, whether you moved here, whether you're born here. There's never been a greater time to start a business than right now. And according to Forbes, 57% of the people listening to this show and 57% of the people in our country want to start a business at some point. So we are honored to be here with you and to teach you the stuff behind the stuff. And join with us today inside the box that rocks, we have Dr. Robert Zellner, the co-host with the most.
Oh, Thrive Nation, how you doing out there?
How you doing? And we have a man who's celebrating a birthday today. It's a man who, if you want to get out of the financial pickle that you're in, if you want to get financially free, he is one of the city's top financial experts, top financial planners. It is Mr. Phil Pickle. Phil, how are you?
I'm doing great. Glad to be here.
Do you ever get asked to be a male model? I guess how often do you get asked to be a male model? I mean, I know we asked you to be on the show today as a radio guy, but how often are you going, you know, no, I don't have time to be a male model today. I've got a lot of other things going on. How often do you get asked?
Oh, 2 or 3 times a week at least. But I always say, no, I'm sticking to the radio.
Oh, man, if you're on Facebook Live right now, it's really sort of a buffet of beauty. It's just Dr. Z and Phil, two doctors,
right,
Dr.
Right.
Phil, Dr. Z. Wow, I'm just, hopefully you're not heavily medicated, Thrivers, because you want to take in this glory just as it is. It's beautiful.
It's a beautiful thing. And when we left right before the break, we were going over the wheel deal. We're talking about the 12 commandments to closing a deal. And you as a boss, you as a manager, you as a person in charge, today's show is all about how you can encourage, put pressure upon people to do the things they need to do. And so we're giving you the 12 steps that you can help them closing a deal. And number 7 was ask one more time. When you get the no, you just continue on with the ask. And so we have a system here at Thrive. And if you show up at our in-person workshop, March 24th and 25th, you'll get all the details of that. We call it the Wheel Deal. And Clay was kind of going over a little bit of it. He went over kind of one of the first passes of it whenever, right before the break. And so do a little bit more Wheel Deal before we go to number 8.
Well, the deal wheel, or the wheel deal, either way, the idea is that there's sort of a circular reasoning method. And what happens is, as humans, none of us want to be confronted by a salesperson that will point out to us that we're wrong. So I'm going to use an example, and Phil will be the salesperson in this example, and I am the person who is looking into the product, okay? So you have a product, correct me if I'm wrong, that's called the credit card monitoring product, okay?
That is correct.
So educate the audience. Why in the world would anybody want to know about this program?
Well, basically, it's just an analysis and a monitoring program for your credit card transaction fees or your swipe fees. And there's thousands of mistakes made on those, and it's costing business owners money. And we have a program that's going to put that money back into their pockets, that savings.
So let's say I have a restaurant and I do about $2 million a year of sales. On average, how much money could I be saving if I have you analyze the program?
On average, for restaurants, are about $32,000.
Okay, so I'm a restaurant owner, and you're claiming that with the audit you guys could do, you could potentially give me $30,000 back in my pocket that I'm owed, and you get a check to me. Is this what you're saying?
That is correct.
Okay, so Thrivers, look at this scenario. He knows he can give me $32,000 after auditing my company, and because he knows the system and how to get me money back. Let's just say that if you're listening right now, I want you to doubt what Phil is saying and challenge him. Say, yeah, audit my business. What can you save me? I mean, doubt the guy. To challenge him. I mean, trust but verify. Take the challenge. But I'm over here going, I'm not interested. But you know that you can help me. You know that what you have can help me. If that is the scenario that you, the Thriver, find yourself in, then you owe it to yourself to deal wheel. Okay? So if you go out on a limb, that's where the fruit is. So step number 1 is you want to suck air through your teeth. And right then you go, So what do you mean by that? And you have to ask it like you're either mildly mentally deficient or you're sincerely clueless to how the planet works. Either way.
Yeah.
Because the person just told you, I don't have time to buy. And you go, so when you say you don't have time to buy, what do you mean by that? And you have to sound like you're a gentle man, like you're a sweet man. You're a gentle, sweet man.
Yes, about a third grade education.
Yeah, but you have to be the late night commercial, the guy who's typically asking us to donate to some cause. That's how sweet of a man. You want to be like who is the guy who actually was Santa Claus? It was Christopher Kringle or something. What's his name?
Chris Kringle?
Yeah, so you're actually the original, you're the originator of Santa. That's how sweet you are. You're the kind of man who just isn't in the you're at the city park petting a bunny and you're happily married with 5 kids and they're like, is this person really that sweet of a man? That's how
yes,
disturbing.
Yes, yes.
And then they go, well, you know, the I guess I don't have, now's not a good time to buy right now, Phil, or to meet, because, you know, I've got a lot of stuff going on. Tax season's right around the corner. I don't have time to audit my credit cards. And so how would you, once you kind of are that far, what would kind of, because once you've got them to actually present the real objection, how would you overcome that, Phil?
Well, in this case, you know, I would simply say that, you know, we were talking about thousands of dollars back in your pocket. And really, we're doing the analysis. We're going to take that away from you where it's not going to take your time.
Mm, oh, really?
And then we're also not going to charge you anything if we can't get you any money back.
And see, here's where I would pile on with what Phil just said. Then I would say, there's the phrase. Someone needs to write that down. What you say is most people, you say, well, you know, well, most people, you're exactly right. So you need to write that down. You say, you know, most people that we work with felt exactly the way that you feel now. And you're exactly right. And what we found is that we just get the information from you now. It takes about 15 minutes. We go back to the office. We do all the legwork. And when you get a check for $30,000 or $15,000, let's say you just get $5,000 back from us doing all the work and you taking 15 minutes, you're going to be thankful that I asked you again. So when's a good time to do this?
Boom.
And they're just like, oh, yeah. I mean, so it's a deal of, like, I always tell clients all the time. People say, I had a client the other day. He's in Dallas, and he was saying, Clay, we really, really don't think our website is hurting us. And so I'm not going to argue with him. I said, absolutely. You know, let me ask you, what's your main concern? What do you mean by that? And he goes, well, I mean, I don't think our website hurts us, you know, at all. And I said, well, okay, well, I mean, how many deals do you get a year, you know, on your website right now? And he tells me a number that approaches zero. And I said, well, you know, you're exactly right. And what a lot of people find is that they don't even know how many deals they're losing. But I pulled an analytics report on your site, and you have over 200 people visiting your site a day. But you've never sold anything on the site. So I believe that if you improve it a little bit, maybe you could close some more deals. And that's why our in-person workshops are right for you. Well, then what's fun with these stories is you see these people 6 months later and they go, hey, I'm selling like 2 or 3 deals a month on my site. I mean, so I'm telling you what, Thrivers, if you have the right motive and you believe your product or service can help somebody, like Phil's product, you've got to ask for the deal. So Phil, if I'm listening right now and I want to take the challenge, I do want to compare my credit card fees. I want to find out how much money I could be losing, maybe how much money I'm owed. How can they find out more?
Well, you can go to our website, myanchorgroup.com. You can also call our office and speak with one of our cost recovery experts. It's 918-591-2880.
And if you don't want to save money on credit card fees, there's one great tip for burning money. What you want to do is you want to set it on fire. So you want to get out a match. And what you do, I got the matches here with me. You want to light it. On Facebook Live, you can see I've lit a match right there. And you just let that
fire
burn.
Just light the pinion wood. Don't burn any cash.
Yeah, I mean, you just put it under the money and just let it burn. Don't take the challenge. Stay tuned.
Alicia Parker, and I'm from Tulsa, Oklahoma. I am a business consultant for female entrepreneurs. I first heard about Thrive15 through my husband, because his brother was working for Clay, and then I just heard great things about him. So I was like, oh, I'm kind of interested in what, you know, he has to say about my business or about businesses in general. And so that's what I did. A few things that I've learned during the conference is your goals are very important to have specific, because basically your business is based on what you want your life to be. So that was really important. Oh gosh, I feel like I've learned so much. I don't know what to pinpoint. I've learned a lot about managing people and how you can make your business duplicable by just documenting everything. And that's very important, because your employees and everything can carry your business if you document everything. It's everything that you're looking at is like, it's very appealing to the eyes. It's very motivational, because you have all the quotes everywhere. You have high energy, the music, everything like that. And the conference is very informative, and everything that's in the conference, it's kind of just like hits you. It's like, okay, you need to be doing this, and there's no excuses, so just do it. The teaching style is very funny and informative as well. Everything he says has a reason behind it. It's not like you're just sitting there listening to babbling going on just because you have to have a, you know, 8-9 hour conference. It's every single thing that he says is purpose, and it has a lot of facts, and it's very fact-based, and it's very informative. They're missing out on the exact steps that you need to grow your business. So like he says in the conference, there are all these steps that he gives you, but if you don't take action, then it's not gonna happen. And so a lot of people might have heard these actionable steps like from different sources, but having them all together in a like linear fashion, how you need to grow your business is really important. So like missing out on that is you're not jumbled and you're not confused on what you need to do. It's very specific. It's different because Clay and the whole workshop is very, they want you to succeed, and that is their whole goal. And so he hasn't ever once said, you know, this is what you need to do, but in order to find that out, you need to work with me or you need to buy this new package. It's all like, this is what you need to do and how you do it. And because of that, there's no, you can just tell he wants your business to succeed. And his whole purpose, like he said in the conference, was that he wants to reach millions. And by doing this, he's not hiding anything. He's just helping as many people as he wants. And that's kind of the feel that you really get. I've not felt pressured to be, like, upsell on anything. I think that if I wanted more information asking him, then the value that I could get from it is a lot. But I haven't felt upsold at all. I would recommend it because, like I said, it's the linear way of how to succeed. And it's not like, you know, I'm gonna tell you something over here and then rabbit trail and go over here. It's all very specific and action oriented. So it's like you can just tell and write down in your notes everything you need to do and go home, and it's already in a linear fashion.
I've got this feeling inside my bones. It goes electric, baby, when I turn it on.
All right, Thrive Nation, welcome back to the Thrive Time Show on the radio. Welcome back to your audio dojo of mojo, the place where we teach your wallet how to grow. If you are into some if you want to know more about wallet photosynthesis, then let me tell you what, during this next segment, you want to get into this, because we're going to teach you how to increase your earning, how to sell more stuff. Specifically, we're getting into the details of how to sell, how to effectively communicate, how to close deals. Zeke, give us our next move.
The next one is stay with the buyer. You don't want to be getting up and going and checking on things and leaving the closing situation. You want to stay with the buyer. And I know that sounds, because when you walk away, it causes a little angst in them. So you want to stay with the buyer.
Okay, so Phil, I'm going to tee up the scenario here. You obviously help a lot of companies save a lot of money, and you also help them plan their financial futures. And one of the things you do is you'll go in there and you'll analyze maybe where they're overpaying on insurance premiums. Why do you and Chris not go to the house of the business owner, go to their business, and sit down with them for like 7 or 8 minutes, disappear, go to the dentist, go rent a movie, go get some
or
gas.
Or go get something out of the car.
Get something out of the car.
Go check on that.
Go to Oklahoma Joe's.
And then come back.
Come back with a puppet. Leave the puppet. Come back. Put a kite up in the air. Make some barbecue. Why do you sit down and have an intelligent conversation that's, you know, why all at one time? What's the logic there?
Well, we want to keep them engaged. And you got them, you're showing them this great stuff and they're getting excited, and then you're going to go off and leave them. That won't work.
I have a funny story for you, Phil. You coached me through this. Years ago, I was working with a financial planner, and he asked me to meet at Panera Bread because he said that he could save me money on insurance. And as he's talking, he begins talking about insurance and how he can save me money. And then somehow he pivots into a mutual fund discussion, and he forgets the very reason why we even had the meeting. And right. So now he's mentally not even present. And by the end of it, he's talking about his kids, and we never got to a point. Can you tell me how an appointment will go with you? Because I am worried that if I sit down with you or any financial planner and I'm talking about insurance premiums, now you can save me money, somehow, Z, it's going to end up in some high-pressure upsell of stuff I don't need. What does that look like? What does an appointment with you look like?
Basically, an appointment with me is, first of all, we sit down and talk with the clients about what they want to accomplish. What, you know, a lot of times it is they're paying too much for their insurance, so they want to save money. And not only do we have programs that can get them savings on that, we also have programs that can get them back premiums back that they've overpaid. And that's a little different angle than most of your people that you run into that are selling insurance. We're not going to necessarily change the company's insurance carrier. We're just going to do an evaluation of the last 5 to 7 years, check the classifications, and I'm talking specifically about work comp insurance, which is overpaid a lot.
How long does this, it sounds like a colonoscopy. How long does this take? I mean, how long of a procedure is this to sit down and audit my insurance? I mean, we're talking about several hours, several weeks.
Basically, I can ask the business owner, I have an automated questionnaire that has exactly 8 questions on it. It takes about 10 minutes. Mm. And at the end of that questionnaire, I can show them a percentage or a amount of money that I can possibly get them back.
If I'm listening right now and I'm doubtful, I say, I'm doubtful. I've got a lot going on. I'm doubtful that you could actually save me. What do you have any sort of claim, any sort of, I mean, not a threat. Don't use my earlier notable quotable about where there's a whip, there's a way. Don't threaten the, what's, do you have any kind of claim, any kind of a guarantee, any kind of move?
Here's our guarantee. If we can't save you money.
Okay, here we go.
It doesn't cost you anything.
How long does it take, though? How long does it take? Several weeks? Several years?
No, it actually, the appointment, real short. Short and sweet. We're busy people. They're busy people. 15, 20 minutes, we're out of there.
You promise?
And then we do the evaluation. And when we do the evaluation, we come back and show you how much money we can get you back.
I'm only beating you up on it because, by the way, what's your website?
Myanchorgroup.com.
I'm only beating you up because, we've all had that meeting where the insurance guy comes to the house and 2.5 hours later, he's
he brings
just
a sleeping
still,
bag, and you know, and he's got, you know, like...
He separates you and the wife into different rooms. He begins to do the separation move. We've all done a timeshare tour, have we not?
Oh my gosh. It just wears me out thinking about it.
And they ask these questions like, so do you care about your health?
I guess you don't care about your family.
Do you care about your health? And you're going, yeah, I care about my health. Well, then what you want to do is you want to... So you're saying this is not any high pressure move?
Nope, we're past that. We don't do that anymore. When I first got into the industry, I was trained that you either get thrown out of the house or you leave with a check. That was your two options. That's not a fun way to approach a career. Okay. So no, we're not like that.
Broadcasting live from the center of the universe, you're listening to the Thrivetime Show.
Z, what are the next moves?
Always treat prospects like buyers. You know, you can, just because you think that person's not going to be a buyer, always treat prospects like buyers. That way you'll turn them into buyers. Mentally, just set the prospect
here's
to treat
a move.
Like a buyer.
I typically used to wear a suit every day, red tie, white shirt, blue suit. Did that for 16 years, always wearing a suit. When I go into Mathis wearing a suit, sales guys would just be on me. They would just, they would find me, come talk to me, because they knew that I was a buyer, potentially. I go into other businesses, and if I'm wearing a hoodie sweatshirt, no one talks to you. So the move is, when my wife and I would travel on airplanes, I'm like, it's a hoodie trip. And I wear a hoodie because I don't want anyone talking to me, selling me something. But you don't ever want to disqualify or have a bias and write somebody off because of the way they dress or the way they look, because some of the wealthiest people around you are very, very frugal in their dress and they're very conservative in their appearance and their dress. So don't prejudge prospects.
And some, like you just said, do it on purpose to try to keep people from coming up to them and trying to sell them stuff. I mean, you're the same guy whether you got on a hoodie or you have on your suit.
Mm.
The last three moves, I'm going to kind of put them together because we're running out of time here, Clay, and I want to get all 12 of these moves out here. But they go like this, and we can kind of break them down and talk about them a little bit. But the number 10 is stay confident. Number 11 is be positive. Mm. And I tell you what, that goes a long way making the close, being just showing up positive, all that negativity out of it. And 12 is, it sounds self-evident, but always smile.
I'll tell you this. You can be confident, and you can be happy and smile if you believe in your product. So if you're selling something right now you don't believe in, switch jobs. If you're selling something you believe in, get all in it. So I'm going to ask you this, Phil. This is your chance. Tulsa wants to know, okay, because you're confident in your product. You're happy to, you're happy to be here on the show with the listeners. I know you want to help them. What if you could say, listeners, please do this one thing. Here's the challenge. What's your challenge for every listener right now?
Well, I just challenge anybody to call in and let us give you an evaluation and see if we can get you money back. If we can't get you any money back, it's not going to cost you anything.
What's the phone number, man?
It is 918-591-2880.
Now, Thrive Nation, we have something coming up exciting in just a few days. It's our next in-person Thrivetime workshop. And if you wanted, if you ever kind of wondered, what is that? Well, one is it's super affordable, meaning that we have a scholarship program. So we have never, ever in the history of Thrive15.com, we've been at it for about 4 years now, we've never turned anybody down who's wanted to come to a workshop because of financial reasons. We have a scholarship program. The face value of the ticket is $500. And it's a two-day in-person workshop. And during that two-day workshop, we go through methodically through the Boom Book, which are the 13 proven steps to business success that we've documented. A lot of people want to know, how did Dr. Z build a successful optometry clinic? How did Clay build a super large wedding photography company? How did Clay build a men's grooming lounge chain? How did Z build the auto auction? Well, we have a proven system that we will teach you. In this system, we cover the sales, the marketing, the accounting, the personal finance. We talk about building systems. We talk about time management. You could have an entire workshop devoted just to that search engine optimization, social media marketing. The whole thing is there for you, but you've got to take the first step, and you've got to go to ThriveTimeShow.com and claim your ticket. We only have a few left, so you want to go to ThriveTimeShow.com to claim your ticket. And Z, for anybody who's listening to our show for the first time, we have four ways we can help all of the listeners. What are the four ways, my friend?
With the original way that we started about 3 years ago is thrive15.com. That's thrive15.com. You can go on there and for $1 your first month have access to the best business school without the BS. We have gone around the country. We've gathered up great mentors, success stories, great people. For example, if you're a mompreneur and you want to start a business out of your own spare bedroom, we've got Jill Donovan on there of Rustic Cuff teaching you her secret little moves that she did. You want to learn about time management? We've got Lee Cockrell, who just managed a thing called Walt Disney World.
Never heard of Walt Disney World.
We've got Levine on there, who did the PR for Michael Jackson, Pizza Hut, a little thing called Nike.
Teaching you that the publicist for Nike and Michael Jackson could teach you, and it's all just $1 for your first month and $19 for every month thereafter. Now, Z, tell them about the podcast. Tell them about ThriveTimeShow.com.
Well, you can go to ThriveTimeShow.com, and all our shows are recorded on there. You can listen to them. You can share them with your friends. You know, we're getting 33,000 of them downloaded last year out of 50 countries just last month, over 50 countries. And so this is something you can share with your friends. You can re-listen to this show. Take your notes because you're maybe driving. You could have been at Oklahoma Joe's eating. You could have been doing something. We've got one-on-one, you know, coaching that you can do. We've got our in-person workshop coming up March 24th and 25th. We've got you covered with business.
I'm going to tell you this, though. Henry Ford says you cannot build a reputation based upon what you're going to do. You can only build your reputation based on what you are doing. So take the step. Go to ThriveTimeShow.com. Get signed up for the in-person workshop. And as always, three, two, one, boom! Here's a little song I wrote. You might want to sing it.